Welcome to February 9 and 10 daily current affairs discussion. Our first topic of today is about Operation Cactus. Operation Cactus was basically a military operation by the Indian military on Maldives in 1988. In 1988, there was an attempt by a Maldivian group which was led by a prominent expatriate Maldivian businessman called Abdullah Lutufi. Abdullah Lutufi, he, with the help of some of the Sri Lankan Tamil rebels, he tried to overthrow the government in Maldives. So this attempt by the Maldivian group, it was supported by the armed mercenaries of the People's Liberation Organization of the Tamil Eelam. So around 200 militants of the People's Liberation of the Tamil Eelam militant group, they entered Maldives, and under the guise of visitors, they took control of all the key facilities within Maldives. But they were unable to capture the Maldivian prison, and the Maldivian prison sent out distress signal to the major countries located within the Indian Ocean region. So he requested assistance from major countries on the Indian Ocean region like Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, India, US, UK, etc. Again, the US has the Diego Garcia naval base in the Indian Ocean region, then UK has a lot of overseas territories within the Indian Ocean region, etc. But the first country to respond to that kind of a request by the Maldivian president, the then Maldivian president Abdul Gayoom or Mamoon Abdul Gayoom, was India. India, under the leadership of Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi at that particular point of time, decided to play the role of a net security provider within the Indian Ocean region. Immediately after getting this kind of a request from the Maldivian president Abdul Gayoom, the Indian Air Force airlifted the paratroops of the Indian Army to the Maldives, and the Indian Army fought against the Tamil militant groups, and it liberated Maldives and it ensured the independence of Maldives at that particular point of time. Operation Cactus started on 3rd November 188 hours after the request for intervention. Like around just 16 hours after the request of intervention by the Maldivian president, the Indian military was already there. So due to this Operation Cactus, it has generated enormous goodwill for India within Maldives. Even now, India is considered to be a friend in need in Maldives. And this is due to Operation Cactus. Operation Cactus was that event that forever changed Indo-Maldivian relations. See, Maldives is a country with 100% Sunni Muslim population. So since it is such a Sunni dominant country, it should have more closer relationship with the countries like Saudi Arabia, Pakistan, etc., which are Sunni dominated countries. But India is considered to be one of the key allies of Maldives due to Operation Cactus. Whenever Maldives had faced these kind of crises, India has always been there for Maldives. Again, during the tsunami relief operations, during the drinking water supply issues in Maldives and all, India has always been there for Maldives when Maldives had faced some of the worst crises in its history. And again, India was one of the first countries to recognize an independent Maldives. So anyway, at that particular point of time, the Indian paratroopers, they rescued the Maldivian prison and soon returned the control of the capital and Maldives to the Maldivian government. So this was a very good example for India playing the role of a net security provider within the Indian Ocean region. The British Prime Minister at that particular point of time, Margaret Thatcher, who is called by the term the Iron Lady of Britain, have said that thank God for India on that particular operation by the Indian military. So this Operation Cactus, it was that sort of a legendary operation by the Indian military. And even the American President Ronald Reagan at that particular point of time, he said that the world will always remember India's contribution in maintaining the regional stability in the Indian Ocean at this particular point of time. After seeing the Indian military, these mercenaries, they tried to flee into Sri Lanka, but they were again followed and captured by the Indian Navy. And these prisoners were handed over to the Maldivian government. Now recently, why the Operation Cactus was frequently appearing in the news was due to the recent political controversies and events in Maldives. Amidst the recent political crisis in Maldives, the first democratically elected President Mohamed Nasheed, he was charged with terrorism by the present Maldivian government, which is considered to be a dictatorship by the most of the international community. Now anyway, the Maldivian former president or the first democratically elected president of Maldives, Mohamed Nasheed, has requested Indian assistance in order to resolve this political crisis in Maldives. He has in fact asked India to send its army and to liberate Maldives from the dictatorship government. And many of the leaders from the international community also, they are also asking whether India should step in like it did during the Operation Cactus time period. Anyway, what happened in Maldives was that in 2008, Maldives had a democratic election. Maldives had its first democratic election. And after that, Mohammad Nasheed became the first democratically elected president of Maldives. But later, this Nasheed government was overthrown by 2012 by weeks of protests by the opposition. These protests were actively backed by the police forces and the military forces. And Mohammad Nasheed, what he said was that he was overthrown by a military coup. Anyway, after this overthrow of the Nasheed government in 2013, there was another elections in Maldives. These elections were considered to be a dubious elections or fake elections by most of the international community. And after these dubious elections, the next government led by Abdullah Yameen came into power. Then the Yameen government, there was a lot of corruption allegations against the Yameen government. So the opposition leaders, under the leadership of Mohammad Nasheed, they started this kind of huge protests against the Yameen government. So Yameen charged the opposition leaders, including Mohammad Nasheed, under the name of terrorism. So the Nasheed government were trying to brand these opposition leaders as terrorists and all. And this ultimately ended up in a political crisis in Maldives and all. Now our next topic is about village resource centers. Now recently, why this was frequently in the news was due to the fact that ISRO is establishing village resource centers all across India with the partnership with the selected NGOs, trusts and state government departments. Now, why ISRO is establishing this kind of village resource centers? These village resource centers, they are established to demonstrate the potential of satellite technology for the development of the rural areas. So how can we use satellite technology for the development of rural areas? That is the main aim of village resource centers. That is what we need to remember about village resource centers. Now, what kind of space enabled technologies or programs are provided to the rural areas by these village resource centers? So the space technology enabled services provided by these village resource centers include things like telehealthcare, tele-education, natural resources information, then advisories related to agriculture. Again, the government plans to boost the agricultural sector by using these kind of space technology enabled services. Then career guidance to rural students. And again, another especially main focus of this village resource center is in helping the rural students. So this includes things like career guidance to the rural students, skill development and vocational training to the rural students, etc. So rural education is one key priority to this village resource centers. Now let us see what is the technology behind these village resource centers, or how this particular program, how it technically works. So this is one of the very unique initiatives that utilizes satellite communication network and earth observation satellite data in a very judicious combination in order to serve the needs of the rural population. So this will be utilizing a combination of the SATCOM network and earth observation satellite. Now so far around 18 crore rupees have been spent on establishing 473 village resource centers around the country. Now our next major topic is about the advisory committee on defense procurements. Now recently what happened was that the defense minister has constituted a 13 member committee called RMCOMP. So now recently the defense minister has constituted a committee called Raksha Mantri Advisory Committee on the Ministry of Defense Capital Projects, or RMCOMP. So this kind of an advisory committee on defense procurements was recently established. Now what is this committee all about and what are the terms of reference of this particular committee? This committee aims to expedite capital acquisitions in defense procurement. Now what this means is that this particular committee, it will monitor and expedite capital acquisition projects for the modernization of the armed forces, and this will again boost the military preparedness of the armed forces. The committee, it will be headed by Vinayl Sheel Obroy. Now the committee will have tenure until the end of August 2018. Now the committee is supposed to present an initial status report on identified projects to the defense minister by March 31, 2018. Now this particular initial status report, it will include things like the current status of the projects, then issues, remedial measures and the follow-up strategies that can be adopted, etc. So the committee, it is supposed to present an initial status report to the defense minister by March 31, 2018. And the tenure of the committee will end by the end of August 2018. Now this committee, it has to undertake an independent review and it has to check the status of ongoing critical projects worth more than 500 crore. So the committee, it has to conduct an independent review and it has to check the status of ongoing critical projects worth more than 500 crore. So that is what this particular Advisory Committee on Defense Procurement is all about. Now our next topic is about the Minamata Convention on Mercury. The Minamata Convention on Mercury, it is renamed after the city of Minamata in Japan. This Minamata city, there was serious health damage occurred due to mercury pollution during the 20th century. So by the end of the 1950s and all, there was a severe mercury pollution in this particular city in Japan called Minamata, and that became a very famous incident on mercury pollution. So this very famous international convention on mercury pollution, it is named after that Minamata city, and it is called Minamata Convention on Mercury. So this is a global treaty to protect human health and the environment from the adverse effects of mercury. Now the implementation of this particular treaty, it is mainly focused in the context of sustainable development. So this particular treaty, it will be implemented mainly in the context of sustainable development. Now let us have a look at the major objectives of this particular Minamata Convention on Mercury Pollution. Now the objectives, as we discussed before, is mainly to protect human health and the environment from the anthropogenic emissions and releases of mercury and mercury compounds. Here what we mean by anthropogenic emissions is basically emissions that are originating due to human activity. So this aim of this particular convention is to protect the human health and environment from this kind of anthropogenic emissions of mercury and mercury related compounds. This particular convention, it especially emphasizes on protecting the most vulnerable from the harmful effects of mercury. See, mercury is basically a very ubiquitous metal, and this particular convention, it focuses on protecting the most vulnerable groups from the harmful effects of mercury, and it also protects the developmental space of the developing countries. So even though it places restrictions and it advocates reducing the use of mercury in the industries and all, it still respects the developmental space of the developing countries. So again, remember that particular point. This particular convention, it is really focused on protecting the interests of the poor and vulnerable groups of the society. Also, this urges enterprises to move from mercury-free alternatives in products and non-mercury technologies in manufacturing process. See, mercury is a metal that is very ubiquitous in the manufacturing process. So this particular Minamata convention, it focuses or urges the enterprises to create these kind of non-mercury technologies in the manufacturing process. This will really drive research and development and promote innovation. Now recently, why the Minamata Convention on Mercury was frequently appearing in the news was due to the fact that the Union Cabinet chaired by the Prime Minister has approved the proposal for the ratification of the Minamata Convention. This will be enabling India to become a party of the convention. Now our next topic is about the Competition Commission of India. Now recently, why this was in the news was due to the fact that the Competition Commission of India, or the CCI, it has imposed a fine of around rupees 136 crore on the search engine giant Google for unfair business practices in the Indian market for online search. Now what the regulator has said is that the penalty is being imposed on Google for infringing antitrust conduct. There has been many allegations against Google, like Google is indulging in the abuse of its dominant position in the market for online search through practices leading to search bias, search manipulation, etc. So basically there has been a lot of complaints regarding Google that Google is doing things like search bias, search manipulation, etc., and it is trying to abuse its position as the market leader or its near monopoly when it comes to the online search engines in India. Now the CCI, it is a quasi-judicial statutory body which was established by the Competition Act 2002. It was established in 2003 and it became fully operational in 2009. Now what are the major objectives of this Competition Commission of India? This Competition Commission of India, it aims to eliminate the practices that adversely affect the competition in different industries. So first major objective is to eliminate the practices that will be adversely affecting or that will be reducing the competition in different industries, and protect interests of the consumers and ensure freedom of trade in the markets of India. So basically we have to eliminate these kind of practices that will be adversely affecting competitions in order to protect the interests of the consumers. And again, the Competition Commission of India, it tries to ensure the freedom of trade in the markets of India. Now our next topic is about the Intellectual Property Index by the US Chamber of Commerce. Now recently, why this was appearing in the news frequently was due to the fact that India was ranked at a very low position, at the 44th position out of 50 countries in the Intellectual Property Index which is being released by the US Chamber of Commerce. Now last year, in 2017, India was ranked as 43 out of the 45 countries. Now although India's current rank appears really low, there is a substantial improvement in India's ranking within this intellectual property index. India's overall score, it has been improved substantially. Earlier it was just 25%, or it was just like 8.75 out of 35 in the 5th edition of this intellectual property index. But now it has been tremendously improved to around like 30%. Right now we have a score of around 12.03 out of 40 in the 6th edition of the intellectual property index. Now what are the reasons for India's improvements in the intellectual property index? Now recently India has really improved its score, mainly because it has passed the guidelines to strengthen the patentability environment for technological innovations. So India has passed these sort of guidelines for strengthening the patentability environment for the technological innovations. Then we have improved the protection of well-known marks. Then another area that India has been focused is in initiating IP awareness and coordination programs. And so far India has been implementing some of the key tenets of the 2016 National IPR Policy. And this has resulted in improving India's score in the Intellectual Property Index. The list is topped by the United States, then it is followed by the United Kingdom and Sweden. Then our next topic is about the Battle of Stalingrad. Now why this has been frequently appearing in the news is basically due to the fact that this particular Battle of Stalingrad, it was held during the time of 1942 to 1943. And right now Russia is celebrating the 75th anniversary of the Stalingrad victory. This is a very important victory by the Soviet Union in the Second World War. Battle of Stalingrad, it was a major confrontation between the Nazi Germany and its allies against the Soviet Union for the control of the city of Stalingrad in southern Russia. Now the Stalingrad, it is now known by the term Volgograd. The Battle of Stalingrad, it stopped the German advancement to the Soviet Union, or it stopped the German invasion of the Soviet Union. Now why this Battle of Stalingrad is really important in the Second World War history is due to the fact that this Battle of Stalingrad, it marked the turning of the tide of war in the favor of Allies in the Second World War. The Battle of Stalingrad, it was a major psychological victory for the Allies, and it has further changed the course of the Second World War. Now our last topic is about a very important specialized agency of the United Nations. It is about the International Labour Organization, or ILO. This International Labour Organization, it was established in 1919 by the Versailles Peace Treaty ending the World War I. So this was initially a part of the League of Nations. Now after the demise of the League of Nations, this International Labour Organization, it became the first specialized agency associated with the United Nations. So which one is the first specialized agency of the United Nations? That is the International Labour Organization. Again, remember it. It is a very important point. ILO, it sets labour standards, develops policies and devises programs promoting decent work for all men and women. Now one very important statement that we really need to remember and focus with respect to ILO is that unlike other specialized agencies of the United Nations, the main speciality of International Labour Organization is that the ILO has a tripartite governing structure. See, this is very, very important. Whatever you are studying about ILO, don't forget this statement. ILO has a tripartite structure. What we mean by this tripartite governing structure is that this will be representing the governments, employers and workers. So it has a tripartite governing structure. The ILO, it has around 187 member states. The ILO secretariat, it has its headquarters in Geneva in Switzerland, and it has a global network of technical experts and other field offices in more than 40 countries across the world. Another important point is about an international conference that is associated with the ILO. This is the International Labour Conference, or ILC. It meets every year to adopt new international labour standards and to approve the ILO's work plan and budget. So every year there will be an international labour conference, and it is associated with the ILO. Now recently why this was in the news was due to the fact that in 2015, ILO adopted a recommendation called Recommendation Number 205. Now recently the Union Cabinet has given its approval for placing this new instrument adopted by this ILO, or International Labour Organization, called this Recommendation 205, or this recommendation concerning the employment and decent work for peace and resilience. This is famously known by the term ILO recommendation number 205. So recently the Union Cabinet has given its approval for placing this new instrument adopted by the ILO called recommendation number 205 before the parliament. Now, what is an ILO recommendation? An ILO recommendation, it is a non-binding instrument which seeks to serve as a guiding principle for national policy process. So, again, remember this. This is ILO recommendation, it is a non-binding instrument. So, that's all about February 9 and 10 daily current affairs. As always, for a more detailed look into the daily current affairs, you can download our daily current affairs materials.